Good morning and welcome to the 2020 Ancient Theatre Festival here at Warwick, organised by the Department of Classics and Ancient History. My name is Emmanuela Bakola. I'm an associate professor in ancient Greek language and literature, and my area is mostly Greek drama, and I'm the member of staff responsible for the overseeing the drama festival. We are delighted once again to be in the position to host so many schools from so many parts of the country to enjoy together a project that we're so proud of, especially as it has resulted from the hard work of our students and their imaginative collaboration with their lecturers over several months. So thank you for coming, and we hope that you will find the day entertaining, intellectually stimulating, and inspiring. This Ancient Theatre Festival for Schools has become one of the most important events in the departmental calendar. And as you can probably see from your surroundings in this beautiful space and from the set on the stage, it is increasingly ambitious, both materially and intellectually. For the fulfillment of our material ambition, we are grateful to the British Academy, who are funding the entire festival, and also to the Warwick Academic Resourcing Committee, without the financial support of which this would have never been possible. For the intellectual aspect, we only find it natural that the drama festival and the student production have evolved into the ambitious projects that they are. The Department of Classics and Ancient History provides the students with ample opportunities to explore every aspect of the ancient world, from its material culture to its history, its political institutions, its society, its arts. All these aspects of the classical world are hugely important for understanding an event so multidimensional and so multifaceted as the theatre of the ancient Greek world. If you want to find out more about the process of putting this production together and also the opportunities that it has offered the students to develop creative skills, please have a look at the production program which will be distributed later on, which they lovingly put together, and also, of course, our dedicated website for the Ancient Drama Festival, which also has all video recordings of performances and lectures from previous years as well. If you want, if you are considering Warwick as a place for study, there also will be details for our next open days in the back cover. So now, this morning you are going to hear from Michael Scott later on the context, the historical context of Oedipus the King. But first, before I pass over to Michael, let me say a few words about theatre in the Greek world to give you a context. So what is important to remember is that theatre in the Greek world is not a peculiar in the fact that it is a performative medium. This is because Greek culture is fundamentally performance culture. So theatre, essentially, doesn't stand out as something different. It is a part and parcel of this performance culture as we know it. There were performances in the Greek world. We know mostly about the Athenian performances, but there were performances all around the Greek world, local and also pan-Hellenic, so assembling communities from all around the Greek-speaking world. This was a big part of Greek life. These were music and dance performances, instrumental performances, rhapsodic performances, performances of poetry, often combined with athletic performances like the Olympic Games or religious athletic festivals like the Olympic Games and religious festivals as well. All of them, and that's again another extremely important aspect of Greek performance culture, always in a competitive context. Okay, so performance is always for prizes. So you would expect that this kind of media would be communicated in performance and. As part of these festivals. What is very interesting also to know and for you to understand how pervasive is performance in the ancient Greek world is that things like philosophy and science were also disseminated very much in performance in front of a public, okay? We are in an oral culture where the main means of communication is speaking or communicating in a public context. You should also take as part of this, you know, performance culture, the political life of ancient Greece. Again, we know mostly about Athens, but we know quite a lot about other cities as well, and especially in the cities where there is democracy. You can imagine that performance, the rhetorical skills, are a big part of that political life and decision making. Public trials, court processes, again, a part of that public performance culture. Even something as esoteric that we understand today as religion, okay, was also part of this performance culture. Greek religion is profoundly embedded in every aspect of Greek life, and the major aspects at the heart of religion is, of course, ritual and cult, which are profoundly performative processes. Hence, processions and spectacle were part of religious process, and of course, public participation. So, this is what I want you to take. One of the major things I want you to take with you today is that the Theatre of Ancient Athens is part and product. Of course, it inherits all of that performance culture of this all-encompassing song and performance culture. And as an experience, you can imagine, or you can start seeing now, it was very different from today's experience of going to the theatre. And to give you an image for this. I mean, this is basically the space of, you know, going to the theatre today. I mean, the experience of going to the theatre in the ancient world could not have been more different than this, okay, as opposed to an enclosed space, which operates mainly in the evenings with artificial lighting, with a seating that reaches, I mean, at best, you know, 1,000, 2,000 audience. Theatre in the Greek world was performed in outdoor spaces as part of these enormous dramatic festivals, which involved the whole city of Athens. So outdoor spaces from early morning until later afternoon, in exposed to the weather, exposed to the elements, okay, with a vista of the landscape all around you, and with fellow participants whose numbers would have reached from around 6,000 to up to 12,000 or 15,000 in the 4th century. Again, part of the festivals of Greek polis, again, Athens we know the most about, but I will explain to you also how theatre travelled all around the world, in spaces in outdoor spaces like these. Now, talking about these dramatic festivals, there are four contexts that I want to talk to you a little bit about. The main one, which you may have studied already at school, the Great Dionysia, okay, a 6-day-long festival taking place in Athens, organized and paid by the polis of Athens and the private sponsors as well, organized on a massive scale with a huge investment of time and money. Over 1,200 performers were involved in the performances of the Great Dionysia, which also included, apart from the theatrical performances of tragedy, comedy, and satyr drama, the more Dionysiac of the three subgenres of drama, also choruses of boys and men dancing. Here I have some photos from modern festival culture in kind of in modern Greece, which I mean, I hope you get kind of the analogy. These festivals, what I want to show you is that these festivals involved mass participation of the city, and they were not only about watching theatre, they were also about taking part in large sacrifices and then the public barbecue that would follow afterwards, processions and celebrations. You can see in the middle image, this is actually a survival of a Dionysiac procession that is still takes place in modern Greece at the moment in honor of Dionysus. So this is the 6-day Great Dionysia Festival. This is where I want you to imagine that these tragedies and comedies that you are studying were performed. Most of the time. There was a second festival that was taking place in winter, and unlike the Great Dionysia, which was taking place in spring and permitted international sailing, okay, it was a sailing season in the spring. In the Lenaia in winter, they did not, sailing was not really kind of attempted, and as in kind of for tourism. The audiences were not as international as at the Great Dionysia, because the Great Dionysia was the place to be if you wanted to watch cutting edge great theatre in Athens, and people would have visited even from abroad. The Lenaia was smaller in scale, and also this is also the festival where comedy would have been kind of central. Apart from the Great Dionysia and the Lenaia, there is also another another group of Dionysiac festivals which took place in the demes, or the so-called townships of Attica around. We know about 140 townships, but already in the 5th century, several of them have well-established and well-endowed, rich dramatic festivals where playwrights produce both new and also new plays and also re-performances or of plays. These would have been organized throughout the year around Attica. And as you can imagine, because of the re-performances, they would have been extremely important for the afterlife and for the canonization, okay, of certain plays. So if a play was a hit, like Oedipus, okay, it wasn't exactly a hit in terms of prize, but it definitely appealed to the audiences. It would have traveled afterwards in the other Dionysiac festivals. And finally, something also I want you to take from here, abroad. Theatre is exported to all over the Greek world from already early in the 5th century. For example, the earliest surviving tragedy we have, Aeschylus's Persians, was also produced in the theatre of Syracuse sometime after 472. So the greatest cultural event of the Greek world was theater, and you can imagine what a central and overwhelming also effect it had in the life of Athens above all, but all over the Greek world as well. I just want to give you a few kind of images, a few more images to kind of imagine a little bit more about that festival culture. This is one of the oldest theatres that we know. I told you that the Aeschylus's Persians was produced here sometime after 472. So this theatre is in Sicily, as you can see. So it's one of the theatres abroad for which which commissioned or which received and produced plays in the context of Dionysia abroad or other dramatic festivals abroad. And it would have been actually built in stone already in the 5th century. This is what we think. Another theatre, I mean, because apart from the main theatre of Dionysus that I showed you earlier on, another theatre, the theatre of Thorikos in southeast Attica, another theatre which would have been built in stone already in the 5th century, hosting a very popular and, as I said, well-endowed festival already in the 5th century. So kind of let your imagination kind of free and imagine that apart from the theater of Dionysus, Oedipus, King, okay, we don't know, but it could have well been produced here in one of these the rural Dionysia festivals already in the 5th century. Other theaters, which also hosted extremely well-organized festivals, were not did not have theater spaces built in stone, and even the theater of Dionysus in Athens itself was not built in stone until the 4th century. Now, other things is important to remember is that the theatre developed in Athens in a period where in the Greek world there is constant change, there is constant innovation, constant experimentation, especially in a relentlessly competitive city like Athens. But the theatre developed in a period where extremely important developments happened in Athens and all around the Greek world. So we connect, theatre with the city of Athens. It's a product, cultural product of Athens, which had already fashioned itself as a cultural capital of the Greek world already in the 6th century BC. We say conventionally Greek theatre was born around 574. So that was a time where Athens was still not a democracy, but the tyrannical regime of Pisistratus saw the huge popular potential of dramatic festivals and developed them into a very illustrious event. So theatre was born, in fact, during a non-democratic context, but the theatre that has survived and that we know actually developed during the development of democracy as the constitution of Athens, and also its radicalization as well. It is intrinsically connected with the democratic context. Democracy was instituted in Athens again around 508 BC, and was a radical constitution by 460. Now, if you think that the earliest tragedy, and there was some of the most influential tragedy we have, around 472, you can see the overlap, and you can see how important the democratic context would have been. The Persian Wars, a major danger that the Greek world experienced and managed to fight back, was another event that is in the background of the development of the theatre. The Persian Wars, And also afterwards, the development of Athens into, subsequently to that, and as a direct almost result to that, the development of Athens into an empire with all the external wars, again, that this would have brought, the booming, increasingly booming prosperity of Athens and the role of wealth in the city of Athens. Also issues of imperialism, so how you treat your subjects, all of these things for the historical context, infiltrate into the drama of Athens, both tragedy and comedy. Greek theatre at the same time inherits and engages with a rich philosophical tradition of the pre-Socratic philosophers from the 6th century onwards, from cosmology and natural philosophy to political philosophy, and then the radical, what we call definitely radical. Although, as I said, in Athens, you can expect radical to be almost the norm, okay? There's constant innovation, there's constant pushing of boundaries, but this movement of kind of the sophists has been very much associated with intense exploration of religious, philosophical, political, and social ideas, and the development of rhetoric, and this would have also exercised a huge influence on the culture of the theatre. The earliest surviving tragedy, as I said, that we have is Aeschylus's Persians, and the latest surviving by one of the three tragedians, Euripides' Iphigenia in Aulis, and the Bacchae, and also another play that has been attributed to Euripides, but it's probably not by Euripides, Rhesus of the 4th century. So you can see that the timeline of tragedy is from around, the surviving tragedy is from around 472 to 405. Although original tragedy was produced in well into the 4th century. We know fairly well, only four playwrights from that enormously successful and influential festival and theatre culture. Only four playwrights, Aeschylus, Sophocles, Euripides, and in the comedy, Aristophanes. But, as you can imagine, these were not the only playwrights who composed and produced. We know well over 100 playwrights of tragedies, satyr dramas, and comedies, who would have produced well over 1,200 plays, okay, until the end of the 5th century. Unfortunately, only 43 survive complete, so in a reasonably complete form. So you can imagine we have the 2% of what was produced. That's actually very important to remember when we make generalizations about the theater as a whole or playwrights. Images, and finally, I want to show you some images of what the main theater of Athens, as it survives today, of the looks like. That's the theater of Dionysus, as it was refurbished and rebuilt in the Roman times. But this is the original site. Initially, it would have looked like this. It was basically a slope on the side of the Acropolis with a company, contractors hired by the state to build the auditoria and the Skene building, the theater building of the theater space. And the theater building was huge, almost 20 meters long, okay, with a massive door in the middle, extremely important in the dramaturgy of the place. And this would have been the view of the vista of the from the point of view of the audience. What you would expect to see in the theater would have been normally two or three actors, four in comedy. The tragic chorus of about 12 or 15 chorus members, a hugely important part of the performance. It would have been a musical event, a musical and singing event. So you would have had a lot of singing and dancing by the chorus, singing by the characters, and also musical accompaniment by the aulos player, the player of the double reeds. In terms of scenery, I'm just telling you these things for the original context. It doesn't necessarily mean that this is how we should produce a Greek tragedy today. But that was the original context. Minimal scenery, because Greek theatre worked mostly as a theatre of the mind. So the rich spaces of Greek theatre are constructed usually through the words of the mind, through the description, again, as a part of that performance, oral tradition of Greek culture. So that's my presentation. That is a few words for the festival context of Athens.